It's really nice to see you.
It's lovely to see you, and hello in the future for everyone who will be watching. So, yeah.
So, Sarah Jane Rooney, tell me about all the stuff that you were up to in the creative arts on Teesside long before I came on the scene.
Well, a few years ago, back in 2013, me and a few friends got together and we decided that it'd be a really cool idea to co-create something called Arts Events Teesside, which was just basically a Facebook page for us to mess around on, post news about events and exhibitions and so forth. And we found that it was actually reaching a wider audience than anticipated. So a few years down the line, AET expanded and got mentioned in the Newcastle Journal, I believe. And we got the attention of Navigator North and MEMA. And Arts Events Teesside, in that respect of my role, is essentially just, you know, really curious about what's going on out there. What's everyone doing? Why are they doing it? And, you know, for example, you know, Arts Labs Teesside, really just buzzing to know that it's here.
I think it came about probably because, I mean, for your own reasons, you kind of had to drop out for a while.
Oh, definitely. And that's where I've been. One of the things with Arts Events Teesside, especially with everything going on at the moment, I was a tad concerned that nobody else would pick up and create, you know, their own zines or their own websites or their own newsletters. And instead, what I found is loads of little groups getting together and you know, making the cultural environment for this even bigger than what it was when I first turned up back in 2013.
Yeah, and I guess that was really my prompt to do this. I just kind of started. I just was amazed at the it was things like at first like Pineapple Black and the
Autumn. Yeah.
It's like when I saw stuff you know, stuff that could be boarded up at properties that are no good to anyone, that you know, don't make an area look fantastic.
Yeah.
That artists would be welcome to take over those spaces.
See, I think that's absolutely fabulous again, and that's why I'm so happy to be talking to you, Arts Labs Teesside. I really am, because, you know, it's fabulous. And for me personally, when I first came on, there was obviously Arts Events Teesside. And, you know, we can't forget the fantastic works that Tees Valley Arts have done as well. But, you know, from that, there's, you know, something has emerged from it. And it's more people doing it for themselves, proper DIY to the max. And again, I fully support that. And, you know, that is kind of one of the reasons Arts Events Teesside even exists in the first place. To inform and support and to facilitate when we can.
So, obviously I'm quite relatively new. I started at Teesside about the time that you were running, but I was, you know, I was wrapped up in my degrees. I didn't really get out there and see much of what was going on. So how were things back then, and how do you think it differs now?
I think it definitely differs to now. But back then it was sort of more of a, I guess it was a lot more quieter. Social media, for example, the internet wasn't the way it has become now. And so in the beginning, it required a lot more groundwork of just, you know, being, you know, in the streets, looking in shop windows and looking in house windows and, you know, having a mooch around galleries and attending network meetings with other artists, just to sort of say, well, what is it that we want? And if no one else is going to facilitate this, or they can't facilitate it, then why don't we just do it ourselves? And the thing with Arts Events Teesside, you know, it's, and we've not done it for profit. We've not done it for money. I mean, one of the main, you know, co-creator of Arts Events Teesside is actually Diane Bowes. And, you know, she is a local artist in the Teesside area. Humaira Imtiaz as well. She's another founder. She's actually works for Live Theatre up in Newcastle and Gateshead. And that was because they were impressed with the work of Arts Events Teesside and what she did in basically giving smaller artists and smaller creative groups more exposure so that people were aware of them. John Louis Higgins was also involved as an advisor as well. And he was the one who actually introduced us to Navigator North, which is the lovely, you know, Vicola, they'll get it when they watch this, Vicola. Basically, Vicky Halborough and Nicola Golightly. And, you know, without their support as Navigator North, we wouldn't have been able to, you know, have the opportunities that we've had. And, you know, again, it was purely through, you know, community spirit and, you know, solidarity, sorry. Just basically a sort of shared need to kind of support each other in pushing forward what we wanted to do. That wasn't necessarily for profit or for status or anything like that, but, you know, in terms of support. And, you know, again, I you know, I thank Navigator North for that, because, you know, they introduced us to a lot of people, they provided in-kind support that allowed AET to expand further, with interviews of local artists to local directors. Alistair Hudson, for example, did an interview with Arts Events Teesside a few years ago, you know, when he was the director of MEMA. Navigator North allowed us to branch more into artistic endeavours that were outside of Middlesbrough. And, you know, they provided us space and mentorship and just everything you can imagine. And, you know, for them, who had sort of the same goals as us, although their aims are different, it was really refreshing to see an arts company that kind of put their money where their mouth is.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I had the pleasure of interviewing Vicky a few weeks ago, but I haven't interviewed Nicola. So, you know, I'm hoping that you'll do some interviews. That's one that you can
pick up on. I'm absolutely filled with pleasure at the fact of, you know, I'm going to be interviewing people for Arts Labs Teesside. So thank you, sweets.
Brilliant. And so one thing that I think perhaps has been a hindrance for a long time, but has really helped with all the different things that are happening, like you say, there's still a big DIY scene here. It's been really interesting for me to see, even since I started doing this project, which I started off, like, you know, July last year. So many people like yourself are putting in all their time, their effort, their energy, and probably a lot of their own money over so many years to facilitate in Teesside. And I think, even though they shouldn't have been struggling on their own like that, I think that's helped this DIY collaborative culture to build up that is serving people really well now.
Definitely. I mean, I think it's the northern culture as well. And, you know, I, as you can tell by my accent, I'm not originally from Middlesbrough. I'm originally from London, and I moved up back. I moved here in 2001. And for me, Middlesbrough and the north has always kind of had this attitude of, if we don't do it ourselves, then who's going to do it? And an example of this would be when I first, you know, got involved in the art scene in Teesside back in 2002, because of Kerry Page, who was Marshall at the point, you know, was running a film and animation class at Teesside University, and they were being supported by Middlesbrough's Arts Development. And but, you know, this was from a free newspaper when I found out this information. And as the years progressed, I kind of found like it, there wasn't, I suppose really there's people that need a platform in order to you know, shout from, to basically say, this is what I am, this is what I'm doing, do you like it, do you not like it? And as much as there is a DIY scene, I think it slowly had to grow and had to become more forceful because of the lack of it, the lack of support and lack of exposure in the past. However, because people have stuck to the DIY and see, because people started doing it for themselves, you know, I think they're seeing a lot more positive results that they can fully claim ownership over.
Yeah, completely. Yeah. And,
sorry if I rambled there.
It's all really.
I'm trying not to mumble. I'm stuttering over words, so I do apologise for that.
No, it's really great stuff, and it's, you know, really good for me to have some kind of more historical perspective on it as well. One thing that I was told that in the past, what had happened in quite a few funding opportunities, that somebody local had come up with a really good idea, and they'd got need to investigate it, and then when they'd proved it was a great idea, they'd like someone to be shipped in from like London or Manchester, or
yeah,
they would be assigned to take over the role, and they would have no idea about what's going on here, kind of come with their own narrative of what it's like, and kind of impose that and kind of run away having, you know, all the money and not really done their job.
No, definitely. I think there is a huge problem up north for that. It's kind of like, oh, we're impressed by the South. They want to come up, are brilliant. Let's see how they can make it better. And it's, you know, again, this is where I thank the DIY scene, because it's kind of like, well, hang on, it's our blood, sweat and tears that we've put into this. We've got people shouting about this so-called money we're receiving, even though we're relying on, like, you know, grants and funding and, like, you know, donations and everything else. And because of that, there should actually be a lot more opportunities in the north, because, you know, people aren't doing it for a profit, they're doing it for practice. And because of that, people should be able to evaluate their skills a lot more clearly. But I do see a lot more jobs that I think, on the one hand, struggle to fill the positions in the area. And then on the other hand, don't necessarily advertise those positions to local residents that would be more than capable of doing it. So I think the main problem is a miscommunication and active listening, because then it does cause problems. And people who create projects, and I've known quite a few myself who have created, quite frankly, absolutely amazing projects that, you know, have given the area an opportunity to expand. And, you know, that opportunity in itself would, you know, increase advertising for local businesses and galleries and libraries. And just as they've hit their peak and the possibility to go further, somebody will swoop in and take it from them, and they're left in a position of no legal advice. They're left in a position of wondering what the F has happened and why it's happened. They're left, you know, probably wondering about their own integrity, and possibly, you know, just wondering why, you know, if they've wasted their time, and if, you know, their time was worth investing. And I think a lot of people, councils, for example, need to be a lot more considerate, and people at local authorities and whatnot need to be a lot more aware that when people put hard work in, it's a bit of a slap in the face if projects are then taken away. But again, I think because of this, and because things like this have happened quite regularly in the past, my talking's terrible today. There have been artists who say, from my experience, and people know I'm quite honest about this, I've witnessed artists who are getting, you know, continuous amounts of funding from particular groups. I personally would say call it nepotism, but I've also seen groups that don't necessarily get the same support, and I've seen cliques form because of it. And to me, I understand that we live in a world where politics and whatnot is important, but if you're not listening to what the people are doing in the area, and you assume someone can swoop in and just take it, it's going to create this defense, this need to defend oneself and their work. And so it creates more distance and less trust. But again, because of this, more people are doing it for themselves. And it's like, I feel like in a way I'm kind of repeating myself on this, but that's purely because I cannot stress the importance of actually listening to the creative people that live and work here. They could be a tattoo artist, they could be an illustrator, they could be a sculptor, they could be a woodmaker, you know, it could be, you know, culinary arts or martial arts or anything like that. But the point is, if there's no way to expose these people and their talents, which would then benefit the area to the point where they feel comfortable to go, actually, I do have my town support, knowing no one else is going to swoop in, then why is anybody actually going to try doing anything? It's like baking a cake and telling yourself you're not having a slice.
Yeah, absolutely. And I can see why people would get really disheartened with that. And also, I think the scene, that the entire scene suffers. I remember reading this piece that David Byrne had written about how music scenes happen. And it's all about having those different levels, and actually... Yeah. It's like the tiny venues, the tiny little outlets are the most important. Like at the moment, I'm, you know, particularly places like Shanty and Disgraceland, because they're where people cut their teeth. That's where you first go.
Well, I mean, not encouragement. Just those businesses, again, absolutely fabulous and a fantastic example of what we're talking about.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's, if we don't protect them, if we don't, you know, come together and save our little venues, then the big venues you can't go straight in and play a huge venue. You have to make your way up, and it's where you form your craft, and it's like that kind of friendly environment where you're going to get good feedback, you can see the audience, and you can grow together. And so that's why, you know, I really hope that, you know, some of the money's going to the smaller places that really need it.
I think it will, trust.
Yeah, and exactly, you know, I mean, particularly, you know, I particularly love those places, so, you know, determined to make it so. We could talk to you all day, this subject.
Really, I think, you know what, the problem is, I think we could just ramble to each other all day. You know what I mean? And it'd just be really, really informative, and it'd be really stimulating for us, and hopefully for you guys as well who are watching.
Yeah, absolutely. So what I think is, like, I think we should leave it there, and then hopefully next Thursday, 5th of November, hopefully we can get you down to the auxiliary for my radio show, and then we can go on for a good half hour about all this.
That would be absolutely brilliant. Again, I love the auxiliary as well. Huge, massive fan actually of everything that they do, such as I am about Arts Labs Teesside. And I look so forward to seeing you guys next week, and I will be having my face mask.
Yeah, and just to say on that, you know, with the auxiliary working together with Navigator North at the moment, and that decision that they've made to kind of be driven by their studio, I think it's just like, you know, it's just absolutely just so much respect for that. They are at the point where they could start commanding things. They could be, you know, they could really. Yeah. I think they're big enough, and but they've made that decision to. Guided by the people that,
well, they've got the spirit and the strength just like you, trust.
You hope so much to see you on Thursday if we're allowed out to play.
Oh no, definitely, I'm sure we'll find a way. That's what artists are like. Artists, creative, we're a creative bunch, and we're very innovative.
Absolutely,
never forget that.
An absolute pleasure.
Thank you so much, and thank you for talking to me.
Anytime. Take care, darling.